Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to Sydney Atheists August Talk. Cults are simply religions that have not yet been accepted by enough followers. More specifically, and by Oxford Dictionary definition, cults are a system of religious veneration and devotion directed towards a particular figure or object. Nathan is a teacher, a counsellor, and a member of Cult Information and Family Support Incorporated. Nathan will discuss cults in Australia, how they work, and the harm that they cause in so many ways. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Nathan. Thank you for your welcome.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. I feel very acutely the obligation to be both coherent and interesting this evening, since you've decided to come out on a winter's night, and I'm looking forward as much as you to finding out what it is that I'm going to be saying over the next hour, or less. Apparently there'll be plenty of time for Q&A. I tend to be fairly free-form stream of consciousness in the way that I present. Please feel free to raise a hand, interrupt me if you think that it would be beneficial to the meeting to make some kind of interjection, but there will also be a Q&A later, and maybe long-form questions and statements could wait until then. I wear a number of hats. I am a councillor on Hawkesbury City Council. I've been in that role for less than 2 years. I'm also an elected Liberal councillor, which I suppose poses a particular challenge in a room full of atheists, in the sense that you may prejudge what it is that I stand for and tune out prematurely. If there is a great chain of being in politics, I am still at the bottom of that food chain and still very much engaged in learning about how to be a good civic representative. It is worthwhile, perhaps, for me to state, as an elected Liberal, that I support same-sex marriage, I support a woman's right to choose, I support euthanasia, I believe that climate change is anthropogenic, and I believe that climate change is real and that Donald Trump is an asshole. I didn't want you to tune out prematurely. But whether politics is a vocation or an avocation, I'm not sure. I haven't quite decided. In fact, I'm still deciding what I want to do when I grow up. By my calling, by my heart calling, I am still a teacher. And my master's in teaching from Western Sydney University included an analysis of the general capability of critical thinking in the national syllabus. So I have a particular interest in the teaching of philosophy and ethics to students and in equipping them with a mental toolkit to make their way in a world with a modicum of scepticism as they encounter new ideas that require assessing. To that end, I took up a qualification with Primary Ethics New South Wales, which many of you have heard of, as the secular organisation that is making great inroads into providing a philosophical syllabus to high school students, or rather to primary school students, during special religious education time. So for those parents who do not want their children to be religiously indoctrinated, even if they are attending a publicly funded government school, they can opt out of that, and instead of sitting idle, they can go and take some philosophical training through a syllabus provided by Primary Ethics. And I endorse their work to you. There is a whole other talk that I could give about whether that kind of philosophical teaching is best done in the SRE space, or whether all SRE should be abolished and that kind of teaching should be incorporated into the body of general learning that students do during their regular school hours. Tonight is not the night for that argument. I am also a recent former member of the National Executive of KIFS. I am not a current member, and I need to make that clear. I'm still a strong supporter and advocate and consultant for KIFS. KIFS stands for Cult Information and Family Support. We style ourselves as a volunteer organisation as the leading organisation in Australia that advocates on the issue of cults We try and provide counselling to people who have come out of cults and need to process the experience that they've been through. We counsel people who have lost loved one to cults. And we perform advocacy in the space of legislators and statutory bodies to raise the awareness of the predations of cults and say that Australian society is uniquely ill-equipped to deal with the predations of cults, and there need to be stronger laws against cults. Our most recent conference was held down in Parliament House in Canberra. It made its way onto A Current Affair. Australian of the Year, former Australian of the Year, Patrick McGorry, and Sydney neurosurgeon, was there. It was warmly endorsed by a number of MPs, which is I'm glad to say, particularly Nick Xenophon, former South Australian Senator Nick Xenophon, has been a champion in raising awareness against cults. So, to start talking about cults, we need to start with a definition of religion. And then we need to ask the question about whether the difference between a religion and a cult is merely a difference of degree, or whether there's something particular about cults that allow us to distinguish them in some other way. Some definitions that I came across are common sense definitions, even if it's by Durkheim. A unified system of beliefs and practices relating to sacred things, etc., etc. That's all fairly straightforward. Another one that's been mentioned over very many years in various legal cases that is the definition provided in the Shorter English Oxford Dictionary, which is the recognition of some higher or unseen power as having control over our destiny, being entitled to obedience, reverence, worship, and then the mental and moral attitude resulting from that belief and its effect upon the individual or the community. And the problem is that gets us part of the way there. But what we need to talk about tonight are cults. If this is a good working definition of a religion, how do cults differ? In Australia, the example that I would point to first, of course, is the celebrated case in 1983, where the Scientologists argued before the High Court because there was a problem with the definition of religion. The Victorian government refused to accredit Scientology as a religion for the purposes of payroll tax. And on that small point, this wended its way all the way up to the High Court, and there were reports and judgments that failed to adequately resolve this question, and we are haunted by their inability to grasp the nettle. One of the things that the High Court heard was that Scientology's theories are fantastic and impossible, its principles perverted and ill-founded, its techniques debased and harmful. It employs techniques which further its real purpose of securing the domination and mental enslavement of its adherents. It involves the administration by persons without any training in medicine or psychology of quasi-psychological treatment, and it's harmful medically, morally, and socially. That judgment against the character of Scientology, which of course, if you recall, took on the trappings of religion and the practices of religion and the iconography of religion simply so that they could hide behind the constitutional protection that's conferred for religions in Australia. And people saw straight through it. I'm reminded very much in this context of a great quote by Sam Harris, who of course said, if you wake up tomorrow morning thinking that if you say a few Latin words over your pancakes it's going to turn into the body of Elvis Presley, you have lost your mind. But if you think more or less the same thing about a cracker and the body of Jesus, you're just a Catholic. And this is ultimately the problem. The High Court was unable to definitively declare what is or is not a religion because it's not in the business of doing so. And the problem of living in a pluralist, democratic, individualistic society is that people are free to believe things that are risible, palpably untrue, ridiculous in the face of all the evidence, and which can be personally harmful to a person's reputation, career, finances, or dignity. That's the problem. That's the paradox that we grapple with in late Western civilization, a phrase that I will return to later. Ultimately, the court decided that they would try and have a go at a definition, a belief in a supernatural being, thing or principle, the acceptance of canons of conduct to give effect to that belief, etc., etc. That was two of the justices, and then the rest of the justices says that was bollocks. Here's our own take on this, a particular collection of ideas or practices, ideas that relate to the nature and place of humanity in the universe and the relation of humanity to things supernatural, and so on and so on. This didn't get us any closer. And the thing is, the thing in Australia, if there isn't a particular constitutional protection to freedom of religious belief or expression, Australia is a signatory to the International Covenant on Civil and Religious Belief. And in Section 18 of that covenant that Australia is a signatory to, they take the broadest possible view of what a religious belief is. It says that Article 18, which Australia is a signatory to, is not limited in its application to traditional religions or to religions and beliefs with institutional characteristics or practices analogous to those of traditional religions. In other words, you can say that you are a Jedi or a devotee of the Flying Spaghetti Monster, and it has to be given the same status within Australian society as an established religion that has the imprimatur of centuries of tradition and state sanction behind it. In offering up this definition, a half-hearted definition that we're still suffering from the lack of resolution to, the High Court conceded, depressingly, charlatanism is a necessary price of religious freedom. And now we're creeping towards cults as opposed to religions particularly. If a self-proclaimed teacher persuades others to believe in a religion, his lack of sincerity or integrity is not incompatible with the religious character of the beliefs. And so says the High Court, and therefore, so says the Australian Charities and Not-for-Profits Commission, and so says the Australian Tax Office, and so says every other government instrumentality that forks out your money and mine to religious organisations without imposing an adequate public benefit test. So now that we've tried to capture religion generally, let's talk about cults. And to be kind to you, I'm going to offer you a short, punchy definition and then a more convoluted definition. Here's the short and punchy one. The difference between a religion and a cult is at the top of a cult sits a figure who knows that it's all a scam. In a religion, that person is dead. Now the more complicated and involved definition, which I've drawn from my years representing KIFs and getting a better head around the attributes that you would look for in a cult. Now, the thing that I want to point out first and foremost is that dumb people are not the only people that join cults. Smart people join cults. People going through a particular point of vulnerability in their lives are subject to the predations of cults. And if you can leave tonight with anything, it's not to oversimplify the question of who would be stupid enough to join a cult. I know this because I lost somebody very dear to me to a cult, and they weren't dumb. I'll come to that. But the thing that cults will always do, overwhelmingly, is accept you. Because cults are not in the business of saying, follow us and we will bleed you off the affection of your family, isolate you, squash your critical thinking skills, and take away all of your money until you are an empty and regretful shell of the person that you used to be. No cult does that. In fact, what's really quite peculiar is that cults feel that they're doing good by their own perverted definition of good. Everybody is justified in their own heart, or so says the Old Testament, and cults are no different. The most common question that I get is, well, look, are cults mad or bad? Are they deluded but sincere, or are they actively practicing deceit? And the answer is, it is terribly, terribly complicated. It can be either or both at the same time. And again, don't oversimplify a complex question. I've now raced well ahead, doing this from memory when I should have been reading from my notes. Here we go. So cults will make you feel special or accepted, that you have a special destiny that has been denied to you because the world simply doesn't understand how important and good-looking and talented and discerning you are. It is a simple appeal to vanity. And the thing about cults is that they frequently prey upon common human failings. Failings which, I might add, you and I also suffer from. They will tell you that there is special knowledge. The old-fashioned term, of course, was Gnosticism, but special secret knowledge that is not vouchsafed to others, but which will be given to you for only the small price of signing up for their program of courses. Who would be the most famous exponent of that model? Scientology. You do not know all of the inner secrets of Dianetics and L. Ron Hubbard's visions until you have paid thousands and thousands of dollars, and then it's at the end that you're told that the reason that you are such a basket case is because you are populated by astral spirits called thetans, which inhabit your body and which make you unhappy. They're unhappy, the astral spirits are unhappy, because the evil galactic warlord Xenu took them all up in spaceships and dumped them into a volcano billions of years ago, and so on and so on and so on. And the thing is, the internet has been a mixed blessing, but at least it allows the secret knowledge of many of these organisations to become visible and public without having to go through the gateway of paying thousands of dollars. I can never fail to greet a Freemason without saying, oh, how's Jebulon these days? Because Jebulon is their special secret word for God that you're not supposed to know until you are a 30th level Mason. So I go around Masons going, Jebulon, Jebulon, Jebulon. They will, as I've said, appeal to your vanity and your existing biases. Even the Nazis knew this. Wasn't it Goebbels who said that it's easier to prey upon a person's pre-existing prejudices than to plant an original idea in their mind all the time? Things like the belief that you deserve better, or that you have an important destiny, or that my friends or my family or my employer have held me back, or I am smarter than average. As one person once said, You know how stupid the average person is? 50% of people are stupider than that. Which is a statistical certainty, but rather depressing when you state it that way. Our friends Dunning and Kruger are active in this sphere. You know what I mean when I say Dunning-Kruger? Dunning and Kruger were psychologists who did this study about why people consistently overestimate their competence or intelligence. You, sir, are you a better than average driver? Well, yes, I reckon I'm a pretty good driver. I'm better than average. Do you, sir, believe that you are a more intelligent than average person? Most people will say yes. But of course, statistically, that can't be true. So the ability to not only overestimate your competence in any sphere of endeavour, but then to be ignorant of your own ignorance is, again, a common human failing, and one that people like cults are perfectly prepared to prey upon. Next, it is to endlessly postpone fulfillment, because if the cult's promise of you being raptured up to a UFO didn't happen this week, then it's only because we misread the astrological signs and wait till next week, definitely next week. Or if taking this course that was supposed to make me fulfilled and effective and activate my inner power as a human being and actualise my being hasn't done the trick, then it's okay. That was only level one. Look, level two will definitely get you there. Next, isolate you. In other words, take you away from the normal processes of critical thinking that would otherwise act as a tell that you're being fed bullshit. And the thing is, so many cults rely on that mechanism of isolating people and then
it's really quite insidious. You see, another thing that cults want you to do is proselytize, which means that you go out and you proselytize, and one of two things will happen. You'll either get converts when you're the cult, or your existing friends and relatives will push you away, which means that you have just been pushed away from the source of good advice that might otherwise cause you to think again about the truth of that particular belief. Next, an inversion of the norms. So a cult will ask you to invert your normal critical thinking processes and tell you, for example, that opposition from your family is actually the thing that's holding you back. The concern that a friend or family member might express for a person that's in the process of being drawn into a cult is actually interpreted as, well, see, look, no wonder you've been unhappy. All of these people, all of this negativity, you need to reject this negativity and come along with us, because we're happy, smiley people. A sense of permanent inadequacy. In other words, that self-doubt, poor finances, an unwillingness to further commit to the cult is your own subconscious, or worse, the devil, trying to sabotage your own progress and your own self-actualization. For example, a lack of answer to prayer is interpreted, or your inability to access the higher states of consciousness that the paid-for level promised you is not the fault of the cult or of the leader, it's your fault. I used to be a Christian. I grew up in a Pentecostal church. I was told that my inability to speak in tongues or to become slain in the spirit or to experience the Toronto blessing, which was a form of hysterical laughter, was because I was too cerebral. That I overthought these things and that my intelligence was the impediment to my spiritual growth. That hung around my neck as a late teen. I have a dear friend in the audience, hairy gentleman up the back, Aaron, who grew up with me in that church and would know that that's true.
Absolutely.
Yes. It's actually quite interesting.
Aaron, your record was always too cerebral.
That's true. I also was too cerebral. Aaron has a ginger beard. My partner David here has a ginger beard. David was expressing some misgiving about coming along to a meeting of atheists. Now, David is often the butt of my jokes about ginger people not having souls. I said, you'll be right at home. None of these people have souls either. Anyway, slight discursive. Next, obedience and irrational reverence for authority. Yes, you see, you might have thought that I'd have led with the guru figure. The primary indicator of a cult is its charismatic leader. But I invite you to look at most cult leaders. Most of them are banal to the point of paralysis. It's not as though many of them are all that charismatic or have a way of turning a phrase that allows them to win people over with their argument. What they do frequently do is maintain an uncanny degree of eye contact. And this has been mentioned many times. There is a lot that you can do to persuade a person to your cause simply by engaging in a kind of pathological eye contact with them. And it doesn't matter which cult figure that you want to talk about, whether it's Osho or Marshall Applewhite from Heaven's Gate or Jesus of King Roy or whatever, and we'll have a look at some of those later. They're not particularly impressive, but nevertheless, it is true, even though it's lower down on my list, the idea that this obedience and irrational reverence for authority is a defining feature of cults. And the last one in my list is to proselytise, and we've already covered that. You know, the thing that cults want more of is more of them. And if you fail in that enterprise, all you've simply done is push the people away that could have otherwise rescued you. And look, in terms of what groups are operating in Australia today, there are plenty, and I'm happy to name names. Scientology is one. Scientology, by the way, is in a state of terminal decline, and you must not believe their own propaganda about how well Scientology is doing. In the 2016 census, there were 1,684 people in the whole country who were prepared to state that they were Scientologists. That was down 18% from the 2011 census, when they had 2,163, and it in turn represented a 13.7 drop from the 5 years prior to that. Scientologist propaganda would have you believe that there are 12 million Scientologists worldwide. A more rigorous analysis suggests that there has never been more than 100,000 Scientologists ever. The exclusive, yes, and by the way, the best take on Scientology is from South Park. Apparently that's secret. Anyway, I'll leave that as an exercise for you to Google when you go home. The exclusive Brethren, operating right here in Sydney, right here in Australia, by their elect vessel, Bruce Hales. People who are members of the exclusive Brethren are not allowed to read newspapers, watch TV, or vote. Although, curiously, the exclusive Brethren are allowed to donate to political parties. Go figure. They are not allowed to associate with people that are not exclusive Brethren. How about universal medicine? I don't know if you've heard of this one. Universal medicine, run by a chap called Serge Bahayan. Bahayan is not medically qualified in any way, shape, or form. And yet he has hit the news in the last few months for a variety of psychological and pseudo-medical therapies that involve esoteric breast massage. Or esoteric ovarian massage, as practiced by Mr. Bahayan for probably his own gratification rather than another person's healing, and yet was for a time endorsed, apparently, by some degree of Medicare-related funding, and that was just ridiculous. The degree of lack of due process that goes on. Then you've got the likes of Kenja, founded by Ken Dyers. Kenja, he died in 2007, so you hear very little of them nowadays. The one thing that they did come to prominence with over was the Cornelia Rao incident back in 2005, a lady who was mentally disturbed and held in immigration detention, and apparently Kenja was a part of the condition that she was in. Then you've got the family. The family doesn't have many followers these days, but it was created in the 1960s by Anne Hamilton Byrne, who styled herself as a female reincarnation of Jesus. Mm. They taught a mixture of Hinduism, Buddhism, and Christianity. They adopted 28 children, and over half of them were led to believe that she was their biological mother. Of course, that was a lie. And they were severely punished for the slightest disobedience and, as some accounts have since come out, were regularly injected with LSD. Jesus of, there's the family, Jesus of King Roy. Again, not a particularly impressive figure, but apparently, and, you know, he is the reincarnation of Jesus Christ. He said, look, there's probably a million people who say that they're Jesus, and most of them are Masonians, but one of us has to be. And apparently it's him. How do I know that I'm Jesus? Because I remember all of my prior life. Now, in the future, as time goes by and I get closer to and at one with God, maybe it will be a lot easier for some people to believe that I am Jesus. I don't think so. The Children of God started in... The Children of God started in 1968 by David Berg, had over 1,000 followers in Australia in the 1990s, and then there were police raids and children were taken away for sexual and psychological abuse. Small children had to witness sexual acts and engage in sexual acts, and most of those children returned to their real families by the end of 1992. I could go on and talk about the 12 tribes that still operates in Sydney. There's a cafe run by the 12 tribes up in Katoomba, and they also operate in Picton. They denounce the rest of Christianity as the whore of Babylon. They forbid tea, coffee, sugar, chocolate, and the internet, but strangely, a website. When they punish their children, they're beaten with a plastic stick, but are not allowed to cry. Then there's the Order of St. Charbel, run by its former leader, the Little Pebble, William Cairn, who claimed to have 84 mystical wives with whom he would spawn a new human race after the world was burned by a fireball. He claimed some link to the Catholic Church. In fact, claimed that Pope John Paul I was going to appoint him to be the next pope. When John Paul I died abruptly, his only statement was, well, obviously God works differently. He has spent 15 years in jail for having sex with young girls. But here's the thing. What about more mainstream? I mean, it's easy to pick on these odd ones that might have been even small in their day and maybe long since gone. But the thing is, what occupies us is the fact that many of these groups are still going on these days. You've got Mormonism. I'm going to see the book Mormon shortly. I hope that it's sufficiently excoriating. Has anybody seen the Book of Mormon? Is it actually excoriating of Mormonism, or do you think they treat it too kindly?
They don't treat it kindly.
I'm glad to hear that. But the thing is, you know, Mormonism in Australia still only represents 0.3% of the Australian population, and that hasn't varied since the 2016 or the 2011 census. Although they are seemingly credible enough in America to pose, put up a presidential candidate, it's a truly terrifying idea. Jehovah's Witnesses recently appearing before the Royal Commission into Institutional Responses to Child Abuse, because there seems to have been a lot of dark dealing going on in the Jehovah's Witness Church. Again, 0.4% of the Australian population, and again, relatively stable from 2011 to 2016. But then you've got Heaven's Gate. Heaven's Gate, back in 1997, these are the people that committed mass suicide in the belief that they were going to be raptured up to a UFO that was trailing in the coma of the comet Hale-Bopp. Their leader, Marshall Applewhite, took his followers and isolated them. They all had, you know, the same awful haircuts and all the same kind of unisexual clothing buttoned up to the neck. In order to wean themselves off the appetites of the flesh, the males were invited to castrate themselves and have themselves medically castrated. And then on a particular day at a mansion in San Diego, they all took a lethal cocktail of phenobarbital and vodka, wearing identically paired pairs of white Nike shoes, draped themselves in purple sheets, and waited to be raptured up to the UFO. Now here's the thing. They made videos about, and they presented as the most ordinary, happy, settled, expectant people. Their isolation had led them to a fatal mistake. I want to invite you to wonder what it is that makes a small splinter cult like Heaven's Gate that's so compelling to its believers as that they will gladly sacrifice their mortal life in the expectation of a better life, and the likes of militant Islam now. People who are happy to strap suicide vests on and blow themselves up because they believe that in that instant they will be transported to paradise and have 77 virgins. One person once asked an Islamic scholar what happens to female suicide bombers. Apparently, his answer was that they are allowed to tend the garden in paradise. Also, curious fact, male suicide bombers who go to paradise and are given the virgins are apparently also gifted by Allah an irrepressible erection that allows them to have sex continuously forever. So it's a kind of a juvenile, arrested development kind of belief. But the thing is, Heaven's Gate and militant Islam, and perhaps if I might say, more modern manifestations of fundamentalist belief, that's Hillsong, share certain things in common. It's a fixation on the next life at the expense of this life. A belief, not so much in the case of Hillsong, but certainly in the case of militant Islam, that you can blow up stadiums full of young children enjoying a concert and that you're doing a virtuous act. Because this life does not matter. Only the next life matters. The thing about Hillsong, which I regard as, you know, fairly, I mean, not of the same degree. I am not trying to conflate militant Islam and Hillsong. I'm just saying there's a spectrum. And in terms of what we're concerned with in our society nowadays. It's televangelism and militant Islam. Of course, Hillsong didn't cover itself with glory. Brian Houston appeared before the Royal Commission and had to answer for the fact that his father, Frank Houston, was a serial paedophile who, in his dying days, was parked at the church that I attended. A sister church to Hillsong was the unwitting receiver of Frank Houston without the congregation being told what they were receiving was a disgraced paedophile into their midst so that he could see out his days. And furthermore, we were told that Frank Houston was to be given every honour as an apostle of the faith, as a founder of the Pentecostal churches within Australia, and that he was a towering figure who had gone a little bit old and doddery and deserved every dignity in his retirement parked in our fellowship. What we were not told, of course, was that he was a disgraced and defrocked minister who'd been sent to us because there was nowhere else that he could go. And furthermore, Brian Houston perjured himself before the Royal Commission by stating that once he became aware of his father's indiscretions, that he had his ministry credential revoked and that he never, ever preached again. I know that he did. He preached in our church and he preached in other churches. We have date-stamped audio of him preaching in other churches after that revelation was made. And Brian Houston perjured himself before the Royal Commission. So try that off. Anyway, the Australian Vaccination Skeptics Network have many of the same hallmarks. So what I'm leading you to now is perhaps the suggestion that the same defects of critical thinking that lead a person into religious belief generally, or into occult belief, or to various other kinds of woo are kin. The kind of thing that makes you susceptible to anti-vaccination rhetoric, or climate scepticism, or 9/11 trutherism, or moon landing hoaxism, or whatever it happens to be, are similar defects of critical thinking. And then you get into the kind of grey area. Has anybody ever heard of landmark education? Landmark education is not particularly spiritual, but it is supposed to be a kind of self-actualization, self-help organization that helps you become all that you can be. But if you look at their promises up front, it's pretty cult-like.
You're talking about money.
You can have anything that you want for yourself. Anything is available through your participation at the Landmark Forum. You can have, there's a new possibility present in your life. And last point, and they're a product of the possibilities that you invent for yourself, and if you enroll others in the program, proselytization. Landmark education is very expensive, by the way, and anybody that's come through it probably doesn't think very highly of it. Some people do, I don't know why. Again, similar defects of critical thinking. Yes, sir?
What sort of expenditure
A friend of mine did a number of their courses. I understand at the highest level was speaking in terms of thousands of dollars to do that.
They operate from Piedmont, I think.
Yes, here in Sydney. So here's the thing. I wonder if there's a link between that kind of unquestioning devotion to an ideology and, for example, the religious fervour that seems to occupy politics in America these days. A kind of fervour that's caused people to ask, legitimately, the question is the Trump presidency a religious cult? Let's go through our checklist and see whether it matches. Yeah. The group or the leader is always right. Whenever the group or leader is criticised, it's characterised as persecution. Yeah. Anything that the group or leader does can be justified no matter how harsh. Obstreperous obsessiveness regarding the group or leader resulting in the exclusion of every practical consideration. And the group or leader is the exclusive means of knowing truth or receiving validation. No other process of discovery is really acceptable or credible. In other words, if you believe the Trump rhetoric, you're on the money. But if you believe any of those nasty enemies of the state, Trump called them, the mainstream media, then that's fake news. Mm. I was recalled powerfully to a quotation of Hannah Arendt, and then found that somebody had actually applied that very quote to a picture of Donald Trump. before mass leaders seize the power to fit reality to their lies, their propaganda is marked by extreme contempt for facts. As such, for their opinion, fact depends entirely on the power of the man who can fabricate it. It's like that line from 1984, where the attribute of doublespeak is to hold in your mind a truth and a lie simultaneously, and to reconcile the cognitive dissonance by continuously leapfrogging over your critical thinking faculties until the whole thing blends together into a mess. So, I want to give you now a brief but particular case study of what happened to in a particular cult here in Australia. And the story is the story of my own family. I'll gallop through this. This is me in another era of my life, a long time ago. This is ancient history for me, but it's worth telling as a cautionary tale. That's me, my wife Kylie, and my son Liam, who is now nearly 16. My son never left my side, by the way. I'm a single dad and raising him without her input. She was unwell, fell in with a particular cult in the Blue Mountains that has no name, has no fixed abode. They're just a group of wacky people that think of themselves as the only true Christians on earth. Diagnosed her with what they called dissociative identity disorder, what used to be called multiple personality syndrome. They diagnosed her with these.
Aaron? So you're saying they diagnosed
her? Yes, they diagnosed her with this, having no psychological qualification whatsoever, and told her that the multiple personalities that they were encouraging her to manifest were variously demonic, which meant that she had passengers, which meant that she had to be subjected to exorcism in the 21st century. So they messed with her head. They gave these different personalities names. The handwritten notes that I'm showing you were notes that were given to me by a concerned family member of another member of the cult who said, your wife's in mortal danger. She might die as a result of the therapy she's receiving from these people. Take these notes that the cult people were scribbling down and do with it whatever you can. She was taken back to a kind of an infantile state because, you know, she was more pliant if the multiple personalities that she was manifesting were of a kind of an infantile character. She was told that she had been satanically abused by members of her own family when she was younger, and that the reason that she had these multiple personalities was because her conscious mind had shut it down, had created these altars as a protective mechanism to prevent her adult self from ever recalling that these things happened. And it was only under the tender ministrations of this therapy group come cult that those bad memories would resurface and then could be processed. The person known as Kylie apparently never existed. In fact, her parents had given her a hateful name because the word Kylie has the letters L-I-E in it. In other words, her name was a lie. And that the identity that she was told was her true self was one of the more infantile personalities called Hope. Hope told stories about being satanically abused, being held under the house by her parents and fed like a dog, of being buried alive with a dead baby, of being suspended underneath a helicopter over a landmine, field of landmines, of being forced to witness satanic occultic murders in hidden bush locations in the Blue Mountains, of being forced to witness a person have their hands thrust into an industrial blender and then she was forced to drink the liquid. It was fanciful and delusional, and the thing that was obvious is that my wife was badly in need of professional psychiatric care. But these people told her that these stories were true. It ruined her. She was, prior to this, a nurse working in the emergency department of Nepean Hospital. She was a professional, she was a devoted mother, sister, aunt, and had a very conventional childhood. These stories of abuse could not be true because she had three siblings who said, we weren't treated that way. So I lost my spouse to a cult that did these things. They believed, because they were the only true Christians on earth, that there were other satanic operatives that were planted into the mainstream churches in the Blue Mountains. They were on the record as saying that the higher up you are in the coven, the higher the coven will plant you in the leadership of a mainstream church. They took her to a group down in Canberra called the Shepherd's Heart. The Shepherd's Heart specialised in this kind of therapy. What did the Shepherd's Heart believe? The Shepherd's Heart believed that there are UFOs that are piloted by demons. The UFOs were built by Nazis at the end of World War II, and that there is a secret underground base under Mount Hermon in Israel where women are kidnapped, taken to this secret underground base by the UFOs, and that these demonic beings, which are called Nephilim, impregnate women and bring the babies to term, and that these demonic super soldiers are walking the earth today, waiting for their Manchurian candidate moment of activation that will cause them to rise up and initiate the onset of Armageddon. And more scarily is that the people that are so programmed to do that aren't aware of the fact, in fact, you may be one. But somebody somewhere is waiting to push that button and activate your hidden programming so that you will then pick up an AK-47 and go and perform some kind of massacre. And moreover, that any time you hear of any kind of mass murder or gun crime anywhere is that it is in fact a trial run for the onset of Armageddon. These people believe that the British royal family are shape-shifting reptilian demons in disguise. You and I laugh, but the thing is, these are the people that my wife was taken to for therapy. So what did I do? Well, here's the thing. If their own material says, look, we need to address demons, you know, exorcism might be part of the therapy that's going on. My wife was taken to regular doctors who gave the imprimatur to this therapy. So I complained to the Healthcare Complaints Commission. I complained to the New South Wales Guardianship Tribunal. Yeah. I complained to the police. I complained to health regulators in other states, because the Shepherd's Heart were based down in Canberra. I got nowhere. This is why KIFS and its remit exists, because people don't get their heads around that people are practicing pseudo-medical, pseudo-psychological therapy and should be brought to book under the existing rules that are there to make sure that shops don't practice psychological therapy. So what was the response of the Shepherd's Heart? Their manual used to say, ministering to dissociation. Dissociation is in the DSM-5 manual. It's a recognised psychological condition. You know what they did? They changed their manual to ministering to spiritual dissociation, claimed that it was a purely spiritual and pastoral practice and therefore could not be regulated by the healthcare regulator. And the healthcare regulator bought it. This is why we need to become activists in this space. This is John Darnell of the Shepherd's Heart saying, is it true that these, you know, these demonic giant type figures can walk the earth, there they are. I blogged about this, my blog is full of this. I was on a current affair twice. My story was in the Good Weekend magazine of the Sydney Morning Herald. Tim Elliott did a great job of talking about the story that happened to my family and the cautionary tale we represented. And it became, you know, my lot to be a kind of an advocate in this space. I've never been in a cult, but my family has been touched by this cult-like experience. And the thing is, because I could talk the leg off an iron pot, I found that my role within KIFS was to say, there needs to be stronger laws. My God, I'm going to knock on the door of every politician until somebody listens. It might be true that the law cannot change the heart, cannot change hearts, but it might act to restrain the heartless. So my message to you is, yes, if you can, go to the police, liaise with mental health professionals, because sometimes people that are in the grip of cults are at a particular point of mental vulnerability, and professional help may help. go to the regulators, the Healthcare Complaints Commission, if there is even a shade of an organisation practising something that looks medical or psychological, complain about it. So I went to every possible agency in every possible state to try and ask them what their stance was about there being stronger laws or better awareness about cults. I got some headway, not terribly far, some state agencies, I got stuck into the health care, I got stuck into the Australian Charities and Not-for-Profits Commission, who confer tax-exempt status or taxation concessions to organisations that have, you know, this patina of religion but aren't necessarily satisfying the public benefit test. Went to the Australian Human Rights Commission, DOCS, Guardianship Tribunal, and then many of these statutory authorities are, have oversight by parliamentary committees. If there's ever a parliamentary committee, state or federal, reviewing the efficacy of the likes of the Healthcare Complaints Commission, have a grizzle to your parliamentarians and say, well, the Healthcare Complaints Commission is completely toothless. Then I struck upon this as a possibility. Here's a brief tale. Back in 1998, there was a group called the Standing Committee of Attorneys General. It's the Attorney General of every state and territory, plus the Federal Minister, coming together in an effort to try and harmonise law within Australia to make sure that, you know, there aren't irregularities as you cross over from one jurisdiction to another. One of the things that they identified all the way back in 1998, when they put this document together, which was going to be part of what they call the Model Criminal Code, was that there wasn't an adequate definition of abuse or assault. So here's the thing. If somebody punches your lights out, or sexually assaults you, or commits a financial fraud against your person, there is a law that will bring you to book. But if a cult takes away your dignity and weans you off the affection of your family and commits a psychologically violent act against you like an exorcism, there is no law. There is no adequate definition of psychological abuse as a form of abuse. So they came up with this definition saying that harm can include harm to a person's mental health. You'd think that having come through this process that they would then, this would filter down through into every other jurisdiction, because it's up to the states and territories to enact this new definition as part of their own body of law. The only jurisdiction that ever got around to it was the Northern Territory. And they informed me, the last time I asked, that they'd never brought a single prosecution under that clause. I met with the Attorney General of New South Wales, Greg Smith, who was probably the wrong person to ask since he was also an observant Catholic. And he told me that, you know, people shouldn't be too hard on those exclusive brethren because they're just doing the Lord's work. I'd made my way all the way up to his ministerial office to plead for stronger laws, and he was arguing the case for the cults. I was profoundly disappointed. It needs to go before the Law Reform Commission, and the debate about this kind of definition needs to come back up. Yes, I wrote to everybody. So that brings us to the current day. And the thing is, I was initially asked to come along tonight and to offer some commentary on the report into religious freedoms that Philip Ruddock convened together with his committee late last year. I went and presented, others from atheist and secular organisations presented. We were filing into the room as the Australian Council of Churches and the various bishops and archbishops were filing out. Philip Ruddock, being a fairly inscrutable fellow, received everybody warmly and was thoroughly non-committal. And of course, that report was handed to the federal government back in May. I thought that since I was speaking in August, we'd have something to talk about by now. Instead, we are completely in the realm of speculation as to what that report says. None of us really know what it says. Not that that stopped the Australian Christian lobby from jumping the gun and saying that even though nobody has seen that report, it's bound to be inadequate. And what we really need are stronger laws to protect religion in Australia, not to curtail the influences of bad religion. And one of the arguments that I made to that committee when I addressed it is that, look, I don't have any objection to mainstream religion. If people want to believe that eating a piece of cracker turns into the body of Jesus, they're perfectly entitled to that belief. Just don't inflict it on others. but it's when bad religion colours even the good works that religion might do that people should have pause. Well, that's an argument that the Australian Christian lobby don't think much of. I can predict, however, even in the absence of that report, what this report may ultimately recommend, because we've all been here before. Back in 1998, there was another inquiry into freedom of religion and belief that was conducted by the Human Rights and Equal Opportunity Commission. They came up with some recommendations. I wouldn't be too surprised if Philip Roach took his sinecure as the chair of that committee, spent 3 months sitting on his hand, and simply photocopies this and delivers it up. So what did this report say back in 1998? Oh, well, it's our considered position that there should be a new piece of legislation called a Federal Religious Freedom Act. It's disappointing, but that's where we're up to. So here's the thing. People in Australia, or in modern society now, are really faced with a very difficult problem. Because if you ask what's the impulse that caused people to believe strange things? Well, look, there's partly answers from psychology. There's a thing that I heard about recently called hypersensitivity to agency. In other words, caveman ancestors hear a twig break at night outside the circle of the campfire light, and the ones that survive are the ones that say, something broke that twig, something out there with intent to eat me. So this tendency to imply agency to things that happen around us confers a survival advantage. The caveman who said, that's nothing, then gets eaten by the saber-toothed tiger. So maybe that impulse has transformed into a pareidolia of the soul where we see agency everywhere. It's also true that as children, we're told to believe authority. Well, who is it that has authority? Well, a person has authority if they have a large audience, if they have a platform and they have influence over a large number of people. But the thing is, technology has democratised information, so a person that can fit that definition might look like this. How this stands from InfoWars, one of the most egregious internet trolls going. Isn't it curious that it's only this week that Apple, YouTube and Facebook all combined, more or less on the same day, to finally de-platform him and to remove his content from their platforms. Twitter hasn't done it yet. And the thing is, as a person with a slight libertarian bent, I wrestle with this. You see, on the one hand, I'm all for banning trolls, because there needs to be some kind of public sanitisation of our discourse. We're drowning in misinformation. So how can people of good intent get the good information but not get drowned in the bad information? Well, you know, you can turn off that tap. Just like we don't have to invite somebody like that into our lounge room, a company like Facebook, which is a private company, can say, you're not going to spout this bile on our platform, and turn off the tap. But the thing about censorship is that it robs us of our right to see a weak argument fail in the public square in a fair fight. And that ultimately does a better job of getting rid of nonsense than censorship, because all they then claim is that the truth is being suppressed, which is their shtick from the word go anyway. I still punch him in the nose if he was in front of me, though. And that's why I'm so vexed on this issue. Carl Sagan said it best. At the heart of science is an essential balance between two seemingly contradictory attitudes, an openness to new ideas, no matter how bizarre or counterintuitive, and then a ruthless sceptical scrutiny of all ideas, old and new. This is how we winnow deep truth from deep nonsense. So I'll give you a small example. This looks opaque. It's opaque to me. Does anybody know what that is? It's Maxwell's field equations that integrate electromagnetism. In other words, it's the mathematical equations that bring together magnetism and light together under the one theory. It's true. It's verified. It's proven. But it's difficult for us to see the truth in that. unless you have specialist training. You can contrast that with this. We can clearly see that there is no bi-local correspondence between the linear signifying links of party writing, depending on the author, and this multi-referential, multi-dimensional machinic catalysis. The symmetry of scale, the transversality, the pathic non-discursive character of the expansion, all of these dimensions remove us from the logic of the excluded middle and reinforce us in our dismissal of the ontological binarism that we criticised previously. Makes perfect sense, doesn't it?
Yeah.
The thing is, pretentiousness will cause some people to say, oh yes, they're too afraid to say that the emperor has no clothes. This is my challenge as an educator, to get young people to examine critically and not necessarily see a person with their own YouTube channel or large public platform as a figure of authority simply by virtue of their possession of that medium. That is nonsense. This is truth. Hard to tell the difference without a critical thinking toolkit. That leads us to the SoCal affair, where a guy basically deliberately invented the most hokey, fake, manufactured trash, submitted it to a trendy journal, and it was published. It was swallowed, hook, line, and sinker. He was the one that exposed that the emperor as having no clothes. So this is the world that we're in, where we're drowning in bad information. This is part of a presentation that I saw Bernard Salt. Bernard Salt, the social demographer. He came to a local government conference that I was at down in Canberra recently, and he said, look at this. Look at this decline in religiosity. Look at the increase in no religion. You just jump anywhere, and especially in Sydney. He says, but don't look at the numbers. Numbers are boring. You need to look behind the numbers. Look at the story behind the numbers. What this indicates isn't merely a lack of religion. It means a complete loss of faith in the traditional institutions of society. It's the same impulse that causes people to walk away from the church as lose their faith in the ability of government to do good in your life, or for corporate entities to be good citizens, or for scientists to offer up truth that's worth listening to more than some anti-vax skeptic with half an hour of Googling under their belt. It's this loss of authority that postmodernism has given us. And the thing is, we lose something along the way with religion. The thing is, I'm the least likely person to act as an advocate for religion here, but Alain de Botton, in his book Religion for Atheists, opens with this line. He says, the most boring question that you could ask about religion is if it's true. And he encourages people to not throw the baby out with the bathwater. Religion has a utility that was recognised by the likes of Jeremy Bentham, the great utilitarian philosopher. You see, people act more altruistically if they believe that an invisible deity is monitoring their social conduct, even when there's nobody else in the room. Bentham built prisons, that's the panopticon. Based on this principle, people will behave themselves if they think they're being watched. And the invisible boogeyman that sees your hand in the cookie jar, even when there's nobody else in the room, has a certain social utility. And as non-believers, it's something that we have to crack the code of, because this social utility that religion has shouldn't be ignored. Western civilization, I think, is worth defending. And I'm venturing into controversial territory here. I am a conservative politician, so let me try and justify my position on this side of the political fence. The thing about Western civilization is that we take for granted its benefits to us. Pluralist, full franchise, suffrage, equality under the law, a free and open press, an ability to elect bad governments out peacefully at the ballot box instead of at the point of the gun. All of these things are things that people under other regimes elsewhere in the world envy us for, and yet we seem hell-bent on denigrating the advantages of Western civilization because that is some kind of cultural colonial hangover. That means that to say that or to say that in a particular way makes us white or imperialistic. And I part company with people, particularly people that I regard as the regressive left, who would rather seek partnership with, you know, militant Muslims than to defend the very civilization that they're standing on a soapbox in. There was, of course, recently this suggestion that an endowment would gift a particular university with the ability to set up a department and offer degrees in Western civilization. I think it's very curious that that the political left is generally understood as being secular and liberal in small world sense, and the right is populated by religious ideologues who are also to do climate skeptics and a little bit nutty. I think that there needs to be a safe space for what I call a secular conservatism, and to tell you that not everyone wants to implement a kind of religious theocracy in Australia, but that to be a conservative means to wish to conserve what is good about Western civilization that has given us so many advantages, a society predicated on the scientific method where science and the enterprise of human cleverness can cause us to live longer lives, live freer lives, and generally be happier than other competing worldviews that are out there and are competing for airtime. So I've taken the long way around, and I've talked about cults, but I've also talked about how the cult phenomenon is framed by this larger phenomenon of a lack of critical thinking, fake news, a kind of universal credulity that seems to be rising and is imperiling our heritage as a Western civilization, and what it is that we should do about that, and that you should be wary about assigning virtues to only one side of the political spectrum in this case. There are other people like me in politics, I hope. I'm going out on a limb by saying this tonight, if this video ends up on a website somewhere, but it is what I sincerely believe, and that takes me exactly to my hour. So how about that? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Nathan, thank you very much for a fabulous talk. Unless Nathan would like to add anything, we might open for questions.
I think you've heard plenty from me, and I think maybe a discussion led and around the floor. I'll answer questions if they're put to me, but I'm sure many of you have something to say. So.
Thanks for a very nice lecture, Nathan, but I'm a bit disturbed by your conclusion in that your association as if with the left, that we are all just loving, you know, so with militant Islam. I mean, that's a very naive kind of way, because as you have illustrated, it's nothing more than a cult. And also mainstream sees blaming Islam for doing that, and I think it's really very disturbing. Now, the other subject which it disturbed me is the whole thing about your talk on your comment on Western civilization. We know at present there is a debate going on. We know that Abbott is trying to put his hands in. We know that ANU has refused it because they want to interfere in the whole structure rather than leaving it to the academic, right? Abbott wants whatever his name of the group is, the Ramsey Foundation giving that kind of money. He wants to interfere in the running of it. That's why if you hear ANU Vice-Chancellor saying that. And the other thing about Western civilization is association also with the round tables, people like David Duffy, who is promoting nothing more than a white supremacist kind of ideology. Did anybody go to his one in Parliament House? The lack of freedom in free speech last week, right? I refuse to go because it's just a very right-wing, you know, some monologue kind of thing, which David Duffy in Human House in Open Forum is always promoting. about white culture. But surely, sir, with due respect, I think your whole talk was very good until the last end, which I have some reason for.
Well, thank you.
No, it's all right. I was really curious about the landmark forum because I know a little about this, as we had neighbours that were in that, joined that, and I wondered if there was a connection with Scientology.
I'm not aware of any direct link between Scientology and Landmark Forum. But in terms of being kin in their MO, I would say that there are similarities.
Could you elaborate on those similarities? You had a similar question.
A tiered system of revealed knowledge, a requirement to buy in financially, to ascend through the various levels, a core belief that that process will lead you to a higher degree of self-actualization and that you will become a more empowered or happy person as a result of these courses, a belief that the knowledge that's conferred in those courses cannot be found anywhere else, and lastly, a desire to reproduce the group by bringing other people through the door. Those are the similarities that I would list.
Just two questions. One is in regards to pushing the definition of cult. I'm wondering if you have any comments to make about political groups in the extreme left or the extreme right. So thinking of some of the extremist groups on campus and also some of the white nationalist groups.
Yes. So Kif's held an evening several years ago where we heard a very engaging testimony from an ex-white nationalist who now works with young people who are in danger of being drawn into that kind of milieu. And what he illustrated for us are the similarities, again, in the thinking processes, a devotion to a kind of tribal identity. That's perhaps a feature that I didn't put up, but it's equally valid. A sense of tribalism or identity that you cleave to the exception of others. So in the case of white nationalism, a belief in your identity surrounding your race. In the case of a political ideology, a tribalism based around a political system of belief, and again, an active skepticism about the validity of any other way of thinking. One of the things that I was really affected by when I was at uni was reading something by Aristotle. He wrote a book called The Nicomachean Ethics. The Nicomachean Ethics set out this core thesis. Don't go to the extremes in anything. Not in your appetites, not in your practices, not in your beliefs. The happy mean is something to strive for. So the thing about extremist belief, whether it's a racial belief or a religious belief or a political belief or even a hard line economic belief. So for example, there are some libertarians at the edges of my own party that are libertarians to a fault. They believe that every error in society can be fixed by an open market and a laissez-faire approach and minimalist government and less interference in people's lives. Whereas I tend to tread that more middle path as a legislator and to say, no, look, capitalism generally produces wealth, but it has to be yoked, it has to be tempered, it has to be humanised, because untempered capitalism is bad. So maybe the general answer to your question is yes, political ideologies and racial ideologies can have the features of cults, and like with religions, what we should strive for is a happy medium.
And secondly, the Hare Krishnas have just set up a group in New Town, and I'm just wondering if you have any special comments about them.
I have no special knowledge about the Hare Krishnas, except that their beliefs, when you drill down into them, are risible. So, for example, Hare Krishnas do not believe that space travel is possible because their cosmology precludes an ability to believe that there can be any human life outside of the sphere for which human life was created for. So the Earth was created for human life. Humans can live on the surface of the Earth. Their cosmology believes that if you leave that sphere, that we simply couldn't live, and therefore space travel is fake. That the moon landings were faked.
Well, at least they give you free food. That's good enough.
I don't know, but again, you know, that belief is risible. It's nonsensical to you or I, and yet it can be sincerely held by people in the teeth of all of the evidence and in the teeth of the scorn that other people would show if they professed that belief openly. I don't have an answer for you, I'm afraid. No, but I can hear you anyway.
National socialism as evolved under the Nazis and communism as evolved in
Soviet Russia are really terrific cults. And in parallel to that, some of you may know that there's a lovely newspaper in Sydney that's published by the Green Left called the Green Left Weekly. And is the Green Left a cult? They claim to be a sort of a socialist, communist, whatever, but the people who are members, I know some of them, in my view, are incredibly zealous and not all that different from members of a religious cult.
I would say that National Socialism and hardline communism, and perhaps our friends in the Green Left, you know, may show some of the hallmarks of cults. Not religious cults, but cults of ideology. It's interesting you should raise that. I mean, for example, coming into a forum like this, I now style myself as a hard agnostic, not an atheist. Why? Because for me, it's an exercise in intellectual humility to state that I don't have enough information and I don't have the processing ability with my barely evolved monkey brain to make positive assertions about the root cause of the universe. So to proceed with an attitude of humility, I think, is wise. And the thing that typifies extreme political ideologies is an inability to do that, to act with humility. You have your ideology, you reject all dissent or contradiction, and that's a recipe for disaster.
I disagree, that's not humility, it's just common sense. Sorry.
Because
to say that one is an atheist requires a
certain
faith in things we don't
really necessarily know. I might add, for the benefit of the recording and friends or former acquaintances who may end up seeing or hearing this, is that the reason that I have lost my religious faith is because of Christians. Because of Christians. I have seen enough hypocrisy and enough sanctimony amongst former congregants, amongst former school employers, and amongst other Christian organisations to last me a lifetime. And they are the reason that I have eventually let go of my faith. And I am better for it.
You're still lucky you are not born Muslim.
Well, I mean, to become an apostate, having been born a Muslim, is indeed a fraught existence, and our hearts should all go out to people who, if they reject their faith, who come to a point intellectually where they simply cannot give their assent to that belief anymore, place themselves in danger of real harm.
Here I am. I was born Muslim.
Welcome to Australia.
If I can just make a comment and a question, your opening comments about critical thinking is very interesting to me. And something I've thought about, I'm sorry if I'm reiterating, but cognitive dissonance, education and religion, science and religion, teaching, for example, in schools, and I'm referring to you as a teacher. Mm-hmm. And I have this similar idea of there is this great problem of teaching religion to young people and science at the same time, and it results in almost an intellectual surrender, a numbness, cognitive dissonance, and a dampening of critical thinking. Now, when that carries over, religion, into political parties, perhaps this is the result of extremism, is a lack of critical thinking. Now, to my question at the politician in you, don't we have a constitution which guarantees the separation of religion, the separation of the doctrine of separation of religion and the state? Don't we have a guarantee that religion is to keep out of politics? You mentioned Philip Ruddock and et al., who gain their inspiration from God or whatever. But isn't there a guarantee to protect us and to enforce or...
Yeah, okay.
Can't this guarantee in our constitution be enforced that religion is kept out of politics?
Okay. So there's actually three parts to your question, and I'm going to work my way backwards from the end towards the beginning. So the clause in the Australian Constitution that confers separation between the state and the church was styled after a similar form of words that was found in the American Constitution, but the way in which it has become enacted is a little different. Some would say that it's weaker. So, for example, it is regularly the case that religious organisations are in receipt of state funding for a variety of purposes, charitable purposes, educationally, running schools, running other service-based organisations, churches run hospitals, churches run employment agencies, and so on and so on. In America, you would see far less of that. So the firewall between church and state, despite similar wording of the wording in the Constitution, is actually... It's done differently here. Unfortunately, the door was opened by Robert Menzies all the way back in the 1950s or 60s when a Catholic school complained to the federal government that they had no money to build a toilet block in a Catholic school. And and Menzies, seeing a vote, said, well, look, we'll give you this money, and that opened the door, a chink, but it became a flood of government funding for private schools. I myself am now an enormous advocate for publicly funded schools and the government schooling system. And I say that having worked for 20 years in the private schooling system, largely at Christian schools. So now I'm working my way back. You talk about, in politics, this firewall, you know, infecting, you know, public life with religious sentiment. I would hope that all good public policy is informed by the evidence and is not skewed by religious sentiment. And the thing is, even a religiously professing elected parliamentarian should believe in the virtue of public policy driven by data, driven by science, driven by evidence. Whether that happens consistently, who knows? If it doesn't, it's because of the human failings that are common to us all. As an educator, I can tell you that it dispirited me to find that there were schools that I worked in who placed their Christian mission before their educational mission. Even though they were in receipt of government funds, and that the parents of those schools, I mean, at the last Christian school that I spent 3 years at, 65% of our family population within the school were not churchy people. They were simply people who were sending their kids to this school because it was closer, was better resourced, had a good reputation, or had a particular facility for dealing with students that had a particular need, like a special educational need. Nevertheless, staff meetings and professional development sessions were overwhelmingly geared towards the Christian focus of teaching rather than the pedagogical focus of making us better educators. Marion Maddox has written a wonderful book called Taking God to School, where she analyses the whole process of religious schools gobbling up the demographic of government schools and receiving increasing shares of government money and yet having this ulterior motive. And I could make another presentation altogether of the evidence that I've collected over the years of religious schools using their money to promote a religious mission even ahead of their educational focus.
Talking about religion in schools, how is it that the public schools are receiving funding for chaplains in the public schools, and children who are sent to public schools, they should not be forced to take religion, mm-hmm. but it's very hard for them to elect to have ethics classes.
It is very hard.
Because of the government is providing.
That's right.
Chaplains.
So this is a, if I can use the term in a setting like this, a mixed blessing. I, as an educator, am an enormous advocate for, mental health resources for young people. Mental health issues are a real issue amongst school-age people. They're doing it tough. So to have a dedicated staff member as a resource that's available to people that might perform some counselling function is a good thing. Unfortunately, the government has lumbered us with a system where many of the people coming in don't come in with a psychology or counselling professional focus, but they come in with a religious focus, and their counselling is merely an adjunct to what they do. But, would a school that is generally strapped for resources turn down the services of a local chaplain who may be able to provide some good to their student population simply because they were coming from a church background? Many would hesitate. Many would say, look, it's extra staff. I mean, generally we would trust this person to place the welfare of their students first. But in a body like this, you would be more concerned with the fact that they were being proselytised. Well, there are now guidelines that allegedly prevent people from proselytising. I think the whole situation is a mess. Yes.
Yeah, thank you. You said something that I found really interesting, which was that a conservative is someone that seeks to conserve. And I agree, and I kind of see a move towards, this sort of celebration of Western civilization. But something that strikes me, and asking you about how you reconcile this, is that with this desire to conserve, we're desiring to conserve a civilization that doesn't allow gay people to get married, and doesn't recognise transgender rights and all these sorts of things which, some people turn their noses up to certain aspects of it, and I myself am guilty of it. But how do you reconcile those two things? Where do you stop the conservation?
All right then. So the way I would answer that is by remonstrating with people who think that the fruits of Western civilization are effectively the fruits of Judeo-Christian culture over the centuries. In other words, the things that have conferred these gifts on us are the fruit of a religious sensibility, and that, for example, a belief in equality arises from the admonition in the New Testament to love everybody equally. Whereas I would argue that the fruits of Western civilization are the fruits of the Enlightenment, and the Enlightenment was specifically about getting away from the church. It was about introducing a secular way of thinking that posited that humans have the ability to aspire and to be morally good without the guidance of the church, that we can seek to do good in the world without having a religious overseer to reward us posthumously for the good or that we do or do not do in this life. So for those people who say that the history of Western civilization is effectively a Christian history, I would say no. The things that we enjoy are the fruits of the Enlightenment, and that was a secular Enlightenment. The Reformation and the Enlightenment.
Abbott might disagree with you profoundly.
I know Tony, and I'm sure he would.
Yeah, I had almost the same question as him. When you say that you are a conservative and you're trying to protect Western civilization, as I understand, most of our traditional values come from Catholic, Christianity or Islam or whatever. And the main concept of conservatism is that you hold on to those values, you don't, move on from them. So how do you plan to conserve them, and then you say that you want to protect Western civilization, because Western civilization will always progress, like in 1960, same-sex marriage was, it was a criminal, act. Mm-hmm. So we have moved on from that, and something else will happen in the next 30 years, okay? Another thing you said, the left is trying to, protect militant Islam.
That's right.
So what is the definition of militant Islam to, you or I find it that most Australians don't know anything about Islam. I mean, they just think that everything is like terrorism, everything is like militant Islam or whatever. And do you have any example that you can specify here that this is how the Greens or the Labours are trying to protect militant Islam? Because that's a very, you know, serious allegation.
All right then. So again, there's two parts to that question, and I'll do my best to answer it. I've obviously touched a nerve in saying that, you know, to be a conservative and a secularist represents some kind of cognitive dissonance. And what I'm trying to say is that the way in which Western civilization is evolving is itself an exercise in ironing out previous cognitive dissonances. So, for example, the American state was founded on the equality of people under God or under the Constitution, and yet they were perfectly happy to own slaves. That cognitive dissonance took a war for them to iron out and to finally be true to the belief that was their founding aspiration. And in the same way, if you style me a conservative and say, well, aren't conservatives the ones that were opposed tooth and nail to same-sex marriage? Well, the thing is, Christians should have never have been opposed to same-sex marriage. It was a perversion of Christianity, in my opinion, for anybody to be opposed to same-sex marriage. And now that that victory has been won, for those of us who are, for example, advocates for euthanasia, I think it is intellectually untenable as a person of faith to oppose euthanasia, because the sacredness of life does not mean that you hang on to life at all cost. It means that the dignity of life is preserved best when a life that has come to its natural conclusion can allow a person to die with dignity, and that is not antithetical to a religious impulse. And the third part of your question related to, help me. Okay then. And what I meant by that, I suppose, was that I see in what is generally styled the regressive left a kind of black armband view about Western civilization as a whole. And that people will often bash Western civilization, and it is left for people who are right of the political centre to defend Western civilization when the gifts of Western civilization are secularism, are true equality under the law, are universal suffrage, are a society that's premised on the scientific method and not on some kind of mysticism or theocracy. And that generally it is people right of center who are left to defend Western civilization, and the people on the left are conspicuously silent at times when they should be strident. The example that I would quote you was a cartoon that came out after the Manchester bombing. And somebody was being wheeled into a hospital with a limb missing and blood pouring out, and a doctor was standing over them with a clipboard and saying, my goodness, this is the worst example of Islamophobia I've ever seen. In other words, this innocent person had been blown up, and yet the chorus of people, certain people with a certain political disposition, wasn't to identify with the victims of that crime, but to simply climb immediately onto the bandwagon of people who were identifying the perpetrator as a militant Muslim. Which is not to say that we should have anything against Islam, but the thing is, there's something uniquely virulent about that particular religious belief that spawns people who are inclined to blow others up. This is something that we have to address honestly. And it is more frequently the case that people on the right will call the spade a spade, and the people on the left will always demur, even in the face of yet another atrocity of this type. That's the defence that I'm making, sir.
Thank you for this intelligence conversations and all these beautiful informations that you provided me with tonight, and everyone else as well. What do you think of Muslims? I mean, as a background of Muslims.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so, and I cited Islam.
If you pose the question briefly, I'll give you a succinct answer.
Yeah.
If you go to my website, I made a video on Australia Day about celebrating Australia Day. What I said in that video was that the wonderful thing about Australia is that we are a melting pot, and it doesn't matter where you come from, because in Australia Everyone had to come from somewhere, whether it was recently or more distantly in our immediate past. And the thing is, if you adhere to Australian values, that sense of mateship and equality and a certain healthy disregard for authority, then you will be embraced by the nation and regarded as a true Aussie, regardless of whether you're a Vietnamese migrant who's running a bread shop, in the inner west, or whether you're a person who came from Anglo-Celtic stock and you're working out in the bush. It does not matter. You are a true Aussie. So I do not see myself a person and say brown skin, red skin, white skin, or Christian, Muslim, Hindu. I just see people who are equally capable and equally entitled to the inheritance of this nation as an open and embracing and progressive nation.
Because you're above all of that, that's very respected. But there are people still below that, and they do not comprehend the idea.
They can speak for themselves, sir. I think there was a question over here.
Thank you. So you made a brief point towards the end that one of the best ways to combat cults and cultism is to get information out, to fight these ideas on their merits and prove them wrong. But I think the anti-vax movement especially is just such an extreme case of confirmation bias that you can't argue with these people. So what is your advice if you're coming up against somebody who just has such a strong belief that you can't shift it, and the more that you pile truth on, the more that it confirms their bias?
Our mutual friend Sam Harris has an answer to this. He says, look, how do you argue with a person that doesn't value evidence? How do you argue with a person that doesn't value logic? If you go to such a person and you say, water is one part oxygen and two parts hydrogen, if their response to you is, that's not how I think about water, what kind of discussion can you have with them? It's like giving medicine to the dead, said Ingersoll. And the thing is, this question comes up in a much more practical way when people who have lost loved ones to cults come to KIFFs saying, how can I reach my loved one? They are completely captive to this thing that they're in, and their avenues of getting information, skeptical information, is very difficult or non-existent, and their critical thinking faculties have been shut down even if we do have some degree of contact. And our answer, unfortunately, strikes many as unsatisfactory, and that is all you can do is continue to love them and continue to try. And then from time to time, KIFFs as an organisation receive wonderful testimonies, and when people are asked how it is that they ultimately escaped from that kind of environment, usually say something like, there was somebody on the outside that never stopped believing in me and who was always there willing to receive me back even if I had nowhere else to go. I'd burnt my bridges, but I felt that there was somewhere I could go, there was somebody I could talk to, and that seed of doubt, once planted, may take root and may flower. So don't give up. Even if you think that it is a fruitless exercise, you do not know what dark and stormy night somebody will make that escape from that orbit and arrive back blinking and confused out in the real world.
You touched on something near the beginning of your presentation that's always I've always wondered about, and you talked about, it was one of your, I think, 8 or 10 points that defined a cult, the example you gave was the UFO cult people that, you know, it's going to come on this date and then it doesn't, and then the date's pulled back. The one that I think of personally is like yoga and flying. Mm-hmm. I've seen that. But what I wonder is do you have any insight into what is that psychology that, you know, say take yoga flying, I don't know if you've seen that, but they can fly, and they, because I'm sort of thinking, well, okay, the days, the weeks, the months go past, and hey, I'm not flying or getting any higher. And it's kind of like the UFOs, they're coming on this stage and they didn't come, and then they're coming to get us a little bit later. The psychology that you know, what is it that allows that to carry on and not to go, oh, this just isn't happening?
But I'm not a psychologist, but I do believe, and I've observed myself, that people have an endless capacity for self-delusion. Everybody has to create a narrative for themselves that allows them to live with themselves and gets them out of bed in the morning. And it might be a complete fiction. So a person loses their job, but then over the weeks and months that follow, construct a narrative where they were hardly done by. Oh, well, you know, I was too good for that job. And by degrees, they come to a belief that's actually quite fanciful, but they convince themselves that it's true, that they didn't actually get fired from that job, they chose to leave because these people were assholes, or whatever it happens to be. That's a simple example, but I'm sure it happens all the time. And I'm sure that in your quiet moments of reflection, each of us can come up with an example like that, where we might confess only to ourselves, in the wee small hours, that we've actually convinced ourselves about a lie, about something, because it makes life a little easier for us. It ignores an uncomfortable truth. It paints us in a slightly better light, which appeals to our vanity. So if a person consistently believes or practices something that is wrong in the teeth of all of the evidence, well, look, there's this thing called the sunk cost fallacy. The sunk cost fallacy is your ability to throw good money after bad. It's your unwillingness to leave a church or a system of belief or a bad relationship because you've invested so much in it, you've got to keep going. And that to lose face by leaving now would reveal the degree of your folly and the degree of your loss over time, monetarily, emotionally or otherwise. The sunk cost fallacy is otherwise pejoratively known as the Concorde fallacy, because when they were developing the Concorde aeroplane, they realised about halfway through the development that it would never make any money. It was impossible. The costs of maintenance and the fuel and the small size and the limited number of passengers and the limited number of aircraft and the maintenance facilities that were required for it all didn't add up economically. Guess what they did? Instead of sensibly cutting their losses, they pressed ahead and spent even more money to complete the development and to put a number of Concorde aircraft in service and then run them for decades until an accident basically took the whole show off the road without making a dollar. In fact, by losing lots of money. Now, rational people with a business focus chose that outcome because they couldn't countenance the idea of losing face and throwing, you know, cutting their losses. They were prepared to throw good money after bad. Writ large, it's the same psychological phenomenon that causes a person to stay in a church for years because that's where they'd invested all of their tithes. It's where all of their friends were. It's where their sense of social identity resided. The good work that they did in their community was done, mediated through that religious organisation. If you'd lost your faith, to simply walk away from the church means losing all of those things. Your sense of identity, your family, your friends, possibly even your vocation. And that's why Daniel Dennett and others set up what's called the Clergy Project, a safe space, largely an online community, where people who are in religious employment, priests and so forth, who have lost their faith, can gradually decompress from that experience and then find a new way of living outside. Because if your vocation is based on, you know, towing a particular line, it's a recipe for unhappiness. I worked for 20 years in private Christian education because I'm good as a teacher, but I had to profess a number of things that I no longer believed. I'm better off without those things now. And I couldn't abide the church's attitude last year, for example, when the same-sex marriage plebiscite came up, where the principal of the school would casually reference the fact that he would never employ a gay teacher. And the board of the school, you know that painting, American Gothic? Stern, humourless people, that's them. Sending screeds out through the email system saying, we expect everybody toe the line that marriage is between a man and a woman. We had same-sex attracted students at the school. The school PE teacher would stomp about going, sexual preference is a choice. You can choose yourself into it, you can choose yourself out of it. What a terrible, crushing condemnation that is for a young person who's engaged in that wonderful process of becoming and working out who and what you are, and then having that inflicted upon you. So I was glad to ultimately have left that environment. Anyway, that's a discursive answer, but I hope I got there. Anyone else? You draw a line under this when you want to, because I'm just rolling along.
Groups like Amway, Herbalife, would you regard those as cults?
Put it this way, they meet at least one of the criteria, and that is the endless postponement of fulfilment. You need to ascend one more tier up that pyramid before you'll get to drive the white Mercedes like the people in the adverts do. It's curious, and I said this point before, it's the same constellation of faulty critical thinking that lead people to believe things together. If a person is an anti-vax skeptic, they are far more likely to be a young earth creationist or homeschool their kids or to have some other wacky belief because their critical thinking skills are faulty. When I was a regular attendee at a Pentecostal church, I remember being dragged along unwittingly to an Amway event where people tried to sign us up for Amway. In retrospect, it made perfect sense because it was just as plastic as the church that I was going to.
Just want to know if Kips has a YouTube channel, and if not, why not?
It has a website, kifs.org.au. I believe it has some semblance of a YouTube channel. I used to be in charge of it, but left that behind some time ago. You will find there, if you Google KIFS, the videos of the various national conferences that have been held. There was one in Brisbane in 2012. There was one in Canberra in 2010. There have been other events since that I've been less affiliated with. By all means, go home. And I'm sure that the organisers here will, if I send them some links, can distribute it to your community after the thing. Well, the purpose of the conferences was largely to raise awareness of these issues to legislators and to statutory bodies, not to minister to people who are in cults or who have lost loved ones to cults. So the purpose of a conference is largely to say, here are some examples. Why does the law permit this? Why is a taxation concession conferred to an egregious organisation that's actually, you know, bilking people of their money, and yet they can have... they can have a tax exemption as a religious organisation. Why does the Australian Charities and Not-for-Profit Commission not do their job? And so on and so on.
That all makes perfect sense, but at the same time, you've admitted tonight that you've tried all those avenues and failed. Why not reach out to the young people who are being sucked into these...
Well, I mean, we're reaching out in any way that we can, and the thing is, the effort is still a worthwhile one to pursue. The Roman philosopher Ovid said, "The drop hollows out the stone, not through its force, but through its repetition."